This morning, we want to turn our Bibles this morning for God's glory. We're going to turn our Bibles to the book of Daniel, the third chapter. The book of Daniel, the third chapter. Amen. Third chapter, as you pray for us this morning, we see that there are souls that are desiring for God to save them, and we need a church at its best. A church at its best can win the world at its worst. I said a church at its best can win the world at its worst. And the world is at its worst.
That's right.
The Bible lets us know that the evil men and seducers are waxing worse and worse. The world is getting worse. The question is, are you getting better and better? The church at its best can win the world at its worst. The question is, are you at your best? Are you living for God? Are you standing against the odds? Are you standing against the world? Are you standing up against sin and against wrong? In Daniel, the third chapter and verse number one, we see here a story about three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These three men is symbolic of the church. They're symbolic of the Old Testament church. They were representatives of the Jewish nation, the children of Israel. And they were in captivity down in Babylon. Saints of God, friends, we are in this sinful world. They had sin and idolatry all around them. They had the pressures of their known world at that time was coming, was crowding in on them. They were standing, they were outnumbered. You had the very spirit and pressure of sin and idolatry and obedience to sin. Amen. More than obedience to God. And we see that in our world today. Principalities and the powers of this world. Right. All around us. Right. The pressures of this life. All around us.
Right.
And God is looking for a man. God is looking for a woman. That will stand against the odds. That will stand against the pressures of this life. Oh yes, we got pressures of this life. Oh yes, we're going through tests and trials. Oh yes, we go through mind battles, physical battles.
Right.
We go through stress. Amen. Yeah. But thank God we have a God that we can cast all our cares upon. Yeah. Thank God we have a God that knows, amen, the innermost struggles that we're faced with.
Right.
We got a God that understands me when nobody else understands me.
Right.
We got a God that knows your down city. God that knows your uprising. God that knows your thoughts are far off. A God that is touched with the feelings of your infirmities. He knows your weakness. He knows where your weak point is. He knows where your struggle is this morning. And God is a God that's concerned about you. When the world will turn their back on you, God is a God that's still concerned about you. God is a God that still loves you no matter how far you've gone, no matter what you have done in your past.
Right.
God son Jesus to die for mankind. To give us, man, a choice. Knowing that we had a choice in the Garden of Eden. Knowing we had a free will in the Garden of Eden. Brother, if there was no love, if there was no law, there is no love. So God had to put a law in the Garden of Eden to, so man can prove his love to God. Man fell back in the Garden of Eden. The first Adam fell, but the second Adam, which is Jesus Christ, gave us, man, another chance to prove ourselves. And here is three men. Bro, they were against the odds. It says in verse 1, Nebuchadnezzar the king, he made an image. Oh, we got a lot of images. You know why the people can't be saved today? Because they got images in front of them. You know why people can't see God? Because they got things in their life. My question to you this morning, this afternoon, is what's the image that you're bowing to? What's the image in front of your eyes? What's the image you fall weak to? What's the image that, amen, the devil has built up in your life that you can't get the victory over?
Right.
And Nebuchadnezzar, amen, the king, he made an image of gold, amen, whose height was 70 cubits and the breadth thereof 6 cubits, and he set it up in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then Nebuchadnezzar, the king, sent to gather together the princes. He gathered the governors, he gathered the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, man, he got everybody that was in power on his side.
Right.
Today we live in a world where the nation, they don't regard God.
Right.
We got a nation that's against God, brother. This nation was very built on principles, of biblical principles. But, bro, we got the governor, the sheriffs, the chief. They don't care nothing about God.
Yes,
bro, they don't care nothing about the law of God. Amen. Every man is for themselves.
Right.
Every man is for serving some other man, some other image. And the king, he got all the governors and the counselors and the sheriffs and the rulers to come to the dedication of the image, which Nebuchadnezzar the king has set up. And the princes, and the governors, and the captains, and the judges, and the treasurers, and the counselors, and the sheriffs, and the rulers of the provinces were gathered unto the dedication of the image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. And they stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then a herald cried aloud. If it was in our day, it would be, and then a tweet went out. Or a cry was loud on Facebook. Amen. Millions and thousands of people heard it back in that time. A cry, a herald, a post cried aloud to you, it is commanded, O people, nations, and languages, that at the time that you hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, supper, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kind of music. That you fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king has set up. People today are worshiping all kind of music. People are worshiping Lil Wayne over God. People are worshiping, amen, amen. People are worshiping Snoop Dogg and all these modern day, amen, rappers and all these modern day singers. Music that satisfies the flesh and images in your life. That image can be drugs. That image can be a boyfriend, a girlfriend. That image can be anything in your life that you put before God. That image is the thing, the reason why you're not saved. When it comes down to it, and God say, today is your day to be saved. Today is your day to give your life to God. And then that image, what does it do? It pops up in your mind. It pops up before your face. You say, God, I want to be saved, but, and whatever that but, whatever come after that but, that's your image. That's your image. And you dance into the music of that image. You loving it to death. And the same thing that you love is the same thing that's going to kill you.
Right.
The same thing that you love is the same thing that's going to cost you your soul.
Come on, brother.
The same thing that you love is the same thing that's going to cost you to lose out with God.
My God, right.
People are worshiping all kind of music. He said it's commanded that when you hear all the music, he said that you should do what? Fall down, not stand, and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king has set up, and whosoever falleth not down. So here you got a choice. You got a choice to fall down, or you got a choice to stand against it. You got a choice to give in to it, or you got a choice to resist it. You got a choice. You got a choice to bow down, or you got a choice, brother, to take your stand by the grace of God. And whoso fall not down to worship, the same hour shall be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. Therefore, at the time when all the people had heard the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, supper, psaltery, and all kind of music, and all the people of all the nations and all the languages, they fell down and worshiped the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. Wherefore, at that time, certain Chaldeans came near to accuse the Jews. And they spake and said to the king Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. Thou, O king, hast made a law, a decree, that every man that shall hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, harp, supper, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kind of music, they shall fall down and worship the golden image. And you said now, whosoever fall not down and worship, that he should be cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And they said, there are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon. Their name is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image that you set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and in his fury, he commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these three men before the king. And Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do you not serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now, I'm going to give you another chance. If you be ready, then at what time you hear again now, the cornet, the flutes, harp, psaltery, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kind of music, ye shall fall down and worship the image which I have made, it'll be well. But if ye worship it not, ye shall be cast the same hour in the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And I'm going to ask y'all a question. And what God shall deliver you out of my hands?
My God.
What kind of God will deliver you out of my hands? So I'm giving you another opportunity. I'm giving you another chance. I'm giving you another opportunity to fall down and bow down to this image. In other words, I want you to give in, fall down, and give in to sin.
I got it, right. That's
it. Give in to sin. Fall down, bow down to it. Sin got power over you. Sin got dominion over you. You can't control this. And you know what? What kind of God going to enable you to get power over this? This thing got the power over you. Who you think you is? You can't whip this thing. You can't beat this. Bro, I got the sheriffs behind me. I got the councils behind me. I got the governors behind me. I got all the rulers and all the provinces behind me. The whole world is doing it. So you might as well do it too.
Come on, brother.
What kind of God you serve that got enough power to deliver you out of my hands? I'm the man.
Right. Amen, bro.
He said, and who is that God that should deliver you out of my hands? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter.
My Lord.
We are not careful. We're not anxious to answer you. We ain't, in other words, brother, we ain't scared to answer you.
Right.
We ain't scared to answer you.
Right.
We ain't anxious. You ain't got us afraid.
Right.
Bro, that's the way you got to have it. That's the kind of, see, in order to be saved, you got to have a certain mindset.
Amen.
The reason why you keep giving in, you haven't changed your mindset. Bro, they didn't pity foot around the king. fiery furnace. And let me tell you something. He will deliver us.
Amen.
We got confidence that he will deliver us out of your hand. In other words, we serve a God that got more power than the devil. The Bible says greater is he that is in you than he, the devil, that's in the world. The Bible says we can do all things through Christ which strengthens us. Bro, you don't have to give in to sin. You don't have to bow to sin. God is able to make you stand. I want to show y'all something real quick. Hold your place there in Daniel and go over with me to Romans. Go over with me to Romans. Amen. God is able to make you stand. Amen. God is able to make you stand.
Amen.
Glory be to God.
Amen.
We serve a God that is able to make you stand. In Romans, y'all stay with me. We're coming. Our story, our foundation is in Daniel, but we're coming right back. Let's reference something real quick.
Amen.
Romans, the sixth chapter. God is able to make you stand.
Right.
God is able to give you the power to be free this morning. God is able, amen, to give you a power in your life where sin shall not have dominion over you. In verse number 12, Romans 6 and verse 12, the Bible says, let not sin. Are y'all with me? Y'all get it?
Amen.
Let not sin,
right,
therefore reign in your mortal body. Come on now. Don't let sin control your body. Don't let sin control your affection.
Right.
Don't let sin control your passion. Don't let sin have a rule, a dominion, a control, or reign inside of you when it calls you to obey it.
Right.
It said, let not sin therefore control your mortal body or rule. That king, he was a ruler. He
right.
reigned over the people. And he set up an image and he fell down to it. Why? Because the devil or Nebuchadnezzar was the ruler. And God is saying, don't let sin reign in your mortal body. Don't use your body to commit fornication.
Right.
Don't use your body to curse. Don't use your body to lie. Don't let the devil use your body to lust.
Right.
Amen. Sin shall not have control or power over you. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you shall obey it in the lust thereof. In verse 13, it says, neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness. Thank God we don't do what we used to do. Thank God we don't use these hands to steal. Thank God we don't use this tongue to lie. Thank God we don't use these eyes to lust. Thank God we don't use our members to fornicate. Thank God, amen. Sin shall not have dominion or power over you. He said, verse 13, neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and yield your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. In verse 14, it says, for sin, I like this part right here, come on. For sin shall not have dominion. I like that, sir, church. For sin, I don't care what the false preachers say. I don't care if they telling you ain't nobody perfect. For sin shall not have dominion. Oh, brother, you can be in such a place in God that God will give you power. I got you holding Daniel. I got you holding Romans. But hold your place in Romans. I'm coming right back to Romans. I just got the references. St. John 1:12. Go to St. John. Go back to your left. St. John 1:12. All right? Put a piece of paper there or something. St. John 1:12. St. John 1:12. Amen. The Bible says in St. John 1:12, it says to as many. Amen. I'll let you get it. Amen. Sin shall not should not have power over you. Sin, God says, should not have control or reign in your life.
Amen.
Sin should not have control or reign in your life. You cannot, the Bible says, greater is he that is in you. So there's greatness in you.
Amen.
There's greatness in you.
Right.
God, the creator, is in you. God, the creator that spoke the world into existence, is in you. God that took dust and made man out of clay, out of the dust, and formed man out of the dust of the ground, and breathed himself into your nostrils, and you became a living soul. Now that's power.
Yes.
Brother, many people, amen, if you're not saved, you are living beneath the privileges that God has provided for you. Because the Bible says where sin gets stronger and gains in strength, where sin abounds, it says grace, God's grace, doth much more abound. Oh, God's grace, it supersedes the power of sin. So that means that you can go boldly and confidently to God in prayer and receive grace. You can receive grace to overcome sin.
Right.
If you want it.
That's right.
If in St. John, the first chapter, verse 12, it says, but as many as receive Christ, him, to them, to you, he gave you him power, he gave you power. He gave you power. God gave you a measure of power after receiving him. He gave you power to become the sons of God. Go to Acts. Go to your right. Right before Romans. You held a place in Romans, a book right before Romans. Go to verse number 8. Acts 1 and 8. Amen. If you receive Christ, he will give you what? Power. In order to stand against sin, you need power. The reason why you can't stand against sin, because you fall victim to it. You fell weak to it. You fell victimized to it. Every time you come back around, you don't have no kind of boldness, don't have no kind of authority in your voice, don't have no stand. Every time she come back around, just get right on in. Where is your saying? Amen. Acts 1 and 8. Are you there? The Bible says, but ye shall receive what? There it is again. Power!
Right.
After the Holy Ghost is come upon you. So God, you will receive power receiving Christ, but you're going to receive, brother, another level of power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you.
Right.
But ye shall receive power. Now go back to Romans. Go back to your right to Romans. In verse number 14. For sin shall not have. Romans 6:14. For sin shall not have what? Power over you. For ye are not under the law, but under grace.
Right.
What then? Shall we sin? This is the question. Because we are not under the law, but under grace. Shall you sin? Because when you sin under the law, you die.
Right.
You die.
Amen,
bro. But under grace, under this dispensation, people think they can go to God and say, well, Lord, forgive me. I sinned today. And go back. Lord, forgive me. I sinned today. And go back. And Lord, brother, under Moses, you would have died.
Right.
Many sins that people do today, God wouldn't have took it. Brother, his wrath would have been so hot. But since he sent Jesus, Jesus stands between the wrath of God and your soul, saying, Lord, don't destroy it. Lord, let me send a bad dream or something, God. Don't destroy him. Because God don't change. The only reason some of us are not in hell is because of Christ standing between God and me. That's called mercy.
Right.
And here we are, presuming upon the mercy of God. Like we got time. Brother, that time gonna run out. When God say, Jesus, step back. Boom. That's it. The only reason why God has destroyed us is because of his love.
But it's the love of God. He didn't slap us in hell. But it's the love of God, brother. Amen. They got you still breathing, and you still saying thank you, God, when you want to, and cursing out when you want to, and thank you, God, and cursing, and thank you, God, and doing your thing, and thank you, God, and doing your thing. No, God said, I don't want you serving me like that.
Amen.
And some people have the nerve to still be sinning and still working the ministry for God. I got to get my ministry together. God, I got my ministry, and you're still cussing. Mm. That's why we got so many false preachers in the world today.
Amen.
That's why we got so many people that's more religious. See, when I was a little boy coming up back in the 70s, and I hear people back in the 60s, people didn't play with God.
Right.
People didn't play with God. Man, people was real. They'd say, man, I ain't playing with God. I ain't playing with God, bro. I ain't playing with God. Whatever, slaying a cat or whatever, back in those days, they didn't play with God. Today, people got a piece of God and a piece of their sin too. But back in the day, people say, man, y'all pray for me. I know I'm wrong. I'm doing wrong. I ain't going to sit up here and be phony. I ain't going to church. I ain't seen no choir. I'm just not ready to be saved.
Amen.
And when I get ready, but I ain't going to be going to church and praising and thanking God and still sleeping in the bed of a fornication.
Amen.
I ain't going to be doing it. Either I'm going to be is or I ain't. Either I'm going to be I for real or not. Well, there's only three types of people in the world: saints, sinners, and hypocrites. There's only three. Well, these three Hebrew boys, it said, we got some power. We know we got power. But let's finish this here. It says, for you are not under, for sin, verse 14, shall not have dominion. Verse 15, what then? Shall we sin because we're not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom you bow down to, you yield yourself service to obey his service ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. You can only obey one of those two. It says, verse 17, but God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin.
Amen.
Brother, word means past tense, glory be to God. Ye were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart. Come on now. That form, in order to be saved, you got to obey from the heart.
Right.
You can't give lip service. You got to give heart service.
Right.
You can't serve God out of a formality. You got to serve God out of heart worship.
Amen.
Hey, I hold your place there. I'm about to show you what folks are doing today. Go to Ezekiel. Go to Ezekiel. See, people want to bow down to their images, but they want to come and praise God too. Go to Ezekiel. Ezekiel, 33rd chapter. Amen. Hold your place there in Romans. I'm coming right back. Hold your place there in Romans. We're lining it up. Amen. We want to line the word of God up. Praise God. Amen. In verse number, in Ezekiel, the 36th chapter. Amen. Verse number, let's see here. Oh, glory be to God. Amen. Ezekiel, I believe it's 33. Amen. They come before me as the people come. Amen. They sit before me as my people. They hear my words, the scripture says, but they will not do them. Amen. They will not do them. Ezekiel 30. Thank God. All right. Somebody find it for me. Sometimes you got your old Bible and everything is marked there, but I don't want to stop the flow here. Ezekiel, it says 33. They come before me as my people. They sit before me as thy people. They hear my words. Ezekiel 33, 31, you said?
Yes, sir.
All right, yes it is. Yes it is. Thank you. I knew I was somewhere. I was warm. Ezekiel 33, 31. Thank you. Look at the scripture say, and they come unto thee, they come as the people come, and they sit before thee as my people. They hear, see, we got to be careful to come and be a hypocrite.
Right, brother.
They come, they hear thy words, but they will not do them, for with their mouth, that's the problem today, with their mouth, they show much love. we got to worship God from the heart.
Right.
Amen. We just can't give God lip service. Amen. We can't give God lip service. Jesus said, I believe in Matthew somewhere, or St. John, he says, for with their heart, men do worship me. But their heart goeth after their cup. Jesus even said it. Amen. It says in verse number 32, it says, for lo, thou art unto them a very lovely song, one that have a pleasant voice and can play well on the instrument. Oh, they love music, bro. That's the problem right there. They love to come hear that. Oh, they got a good choir. They show up and sing. You just want to tickle your flesh. And they hear the words, but they will not do the word. It's one thing to serve God and do his word. Do obey his word. We don't want to come and just come. Go back to Romans and not obey his word. But it says in verse 17, but God be thanks that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from what? The heart. Your heart didn't go after your covetousness. Your heart didn't go after your image. See, the reason why Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego could stand, because they didn't have worldliness in their heart.
Right.
Are you with me this afternoon? Yeah. Stay with me. Stay with me.
Amen. Yes, sir.
I ain't going to be much longer. Just stay with me, because God want to take us somewhere this morning. But God be thanked, ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from, when you going to start obeying from the heart? Stop saying what you're going to do. Stop saying what you're going to be for God. Stop, listen, when is the right time? Now is the acceptable time.
Amen.
When is the right time? When is the right time? Amen. Go to 2 Corinthians. I'm going to tell you when the right time. You talk about what you're going to be for God, what you're going to do for God. But God is saying, when? Second Corinthians, the sixth chapter. Amen. Second Corinthians. Go over from Romans. Just go over to your right. The next book over to First Corinthians. Then go to Second Corinthians. Amen. Hold your place there in Romans. I'm coming right back to Romans. We're going right back to Daniel. Amen. Amen. We haven't lost our places. Amen. Second Corinthians. When we gonna get it right? When we gonna get it together? Amen. When is the right time for me? Amen. The time for you to get saved is the time for you to cast down your images. The cast for you to throw down those images is the time when God is speaking to your heart. Brother, that's the time to get saved, because that time is to run out. Amen. That time to run out. Amen. We got to get saved in God's time. Not our time. In 2 Corinthians, the sixth chapter, amen, in verse number 6, it says, we then, as workers together with God. That's what God's saying. When are you going to start working with me? Workers together with him. You've been working with the devil. God is saying, when are you going to work for me? Workers together with him, we beseech you that you receive not the grace of God. We told you about the grace of God. It's the power of God that gives you victory and power over sin. We receive it not in vain. We don't want to get saved and then go back to sin.
Amen.
Bro, we receive not the grace of God in vain. For he has said, in verse number 2, for he has said, I have heard thee in a time accepted. And in the day of salvation have I secured thee. By God, there is a time accepted. There is a certain time. There's a certain season to get saved. There's a certain time. There's a certain season to get it. Because you can miss your season. There was a certain time for the people in Noah's day to get on the boat. But one day, God shut the door. There was a time, and there was a season. There was 10 foolish, there was 5 wise virgins, and there was 5 foolish virgins. And the Bible says the 5 wise had their lights with oil, and the 5 foolish didn't get the oil, didn't get the Holy Spirit, didn't get the power of God in their life. And brother, when it came time, their life. light was running out. Brother, if you don't get the power of God in your light will run out. The pressure of light, the pressure of this world, the influence of this world, it will take your light out. You need the oil. In other words, you need the Holy Ghost. You need that second power. To as many as receive him, he gave you power. He'll burn and start your light. But brother, you got to go get that oil. In other words, you got to get saved and sanctified. In other words, you got to get saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. That will keep your light burning.
Amen, brother. But there was five foolish. While they went to go buy some oil, buy means while they went to go try to get an experience with God. While they try to go get what it's going to take to stay saved. The Bible said that's when the bridegroom came, opened the door, the five wives went in, but he shut the door. Here come the five foolish. And the door saying, Lord, open to us. It was too late. Don't let these false preachers fool you and tell you you can get saved when you want to get saved.
Come on, brother. I don't want
that. I said, don't let these false preachers fool you and tell you you can straighten up when you want to straighten. God give you a space of time. God give you a season. Brother, the Bible, God will give us a reprobated heart and a reprobated mind. If he turns you over to a reprobated mind, you can't be saved. In 2 Corinthians 6, chapter verse 2, he said, For he said, I have heard thee in a time accepted, in a day of salvation have I helped thee or secured thee. He said, behold, now is the acceptable, set the time.
Amen.
When is the time to get saved? Behold, now is the day of salvation. Glory be to God. I'm glad I heard God when he called. He give every man a call. Many are called, but few are chosen. And a few are chosen because few accept him. Only a few are going to be saved.
Amen.
In Romans the 6th chapter, back to Romans the 6th chapter. Amen. But verse 17 says again, hope you held your place. But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered unto you. Amen. For this form of doctrine. Brother, there's a lot of doctrines out here in the world today, but there's a certain form of doctrine. There's a certain style. There's a distinct doctrine that need to be preached, that you need to hear.
Amen.
That you can stand with, that will keep you saved.
Amen.
You can't get saved under all these different religions.
Right.
God did not design all these different religions. That's man-made. You got to stick with the Bible.
Amen.
I don't know how many in the world, everybody got a holy Bible, but ain't nobody holy. The Baptists got the holy Bible. The Methodists got the Holy Bible. The Lutherans got the Holy Bible. Jehovah's Witnesses got the Holy Bible and another Bible. Seventh Mormon got a Holy Bible and another Bible. You got all these different doctrines and religions, but ain't nobody living holy. These religions will tell you can't live free from sin. Well, what's holiness? The Bible said, be ye holy, for I am holy. In other words, be like God. If there's no sin in God, there should be no sin in us. Amen. I said again. I said like Spurgeon Jones. I felt a little something on that one right there. I said, if there's no sin in God, there should be no sin in us. Amen. What you mean there's no sin in us? When Jesus Christ came, he came to take away our sins. Matthew 1:21. Give me Matthew 1:21 real quickly. Matthew 1:21. See, turn to the scriptures and keep you awake. Amen. Amen. Keep you on your tippy toes. Amen. Amen. Keep you on your toes, thank God. Matthew 1:21, I change up the plays on you. Amen. Matthew 1:21 says what? And she, talking about Mary, she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, and he shall do what? He shall save his people.
Yeah.
Come on now.
Right.
He shall save his people in their sins. No, he didn't say he should save us in sin. He should save us from sin. Glory be to God. But when Jesus healed, my God, when Jesus healed that woman that was caught in adultery, he told that woman, go and sin no more. When Jesus healed the man in the pool of Bethesda in John's 5th chapter, St. John's 5th chapter, he told that man, get up and take up thy bed and walk and go and sin no more. I thank God when God changed us. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new.
Hey God, he make us new. He make us all over again. He cast our sins as far as the east is from the west. But he cast our sins so far in the sea that he don't even remember it anymore.
Now people, they hold our sins again. I remember when you did this. I remember when you treated me like that. Every year at the Thanksgiving, and they always remind you of the stuff you did. And how you offended them and what you did. God won't do that to you. If your sins come back up, that's the devil trying to discourage you. If your sins come back up to your mind, you got to cast those thoughts down.
Amen.
All right, let's move right along. Romans. Amen. Let's look at verse number 18. Then we're going back to the three Hebrew boys. Because see, we got to get this to know why they had such a stand against the king. It says in verse 18, being then made free from sin, ye became servants of righteousness. They wasn't serving the king. They were serving God. They were serving God. In verse number 8, in verse number 22, it says, being now made what? Huh? Are y'all there? Romans 6:22. Being now, but now, being made what?
Free from sin.
Free from sin. We just read in Matthew that Jesus Christ came to save us from sin. Many people say, well, you can't live free. You can't live from sin in this world. Yes, you got a choice to commit it. Sin can be all around you, but you don't have to commit it. Nobody putting a gun to your head to make you commit it.
Yeah.
You may say, well, there's stuff we don't do. We know that we do that we don't know about. Well, God ain't talking about it. That's ignorance. God's not talking about stuff that we don't know is right. He don't hold us for things that we don't have a knowledge is wrong from right from wrong. God wouldn't do that. He wouldn't put us in hell for stuff we're doing that we don't know is wrong. We go to hell because we knew.
Right.
That's it.
We don't go to hell because stuff we don't know. So we all got sin. Well, maybe there are some things in us that we don't know that God has revealed to us. But we're held accountable for the stuff we do know.
Amen.
Come on now.
Yes.
Amen. Are we committing anything we do know? All right. Let's look at this here. Verse 22, but now being made free from sin and become servants, not to Nebuchadnezzar, not to the devil, but to God, and have your fruit unto holiness and the end, everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life.
Yes.
Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Go into Romans, the 14th chapter. Go into the 14th chapter and look at verse number 4. Romans, the 14th chapter, verse 4. It says, who art thou that judgest another man's servant? To his own master he standeth or falleth. But yea, or yes, he shall be holding up. I thank God that the three Hebrew boys, they didn't fall. They didn't bow down. It says, look at verse 4. It says, for God is able to make him stand. God is able to make you stand. What is it that God wants you to stand against?
Amen.
Go to Jude. Jude is the last book next to Revelation. Revelation is the last book in the Bible. Go to Jude, verse number 24. Jude only has one chapter in it. God is able to make you stand this morning. God is able to give you the grace to stand. All right, Jude. All right, we're narrowing it down to our conclusion. Amen. Let you go home. Jude. Amen. Jude 24, now unto him, you got to say amen?
Amen.
Make sure everyone has it. It says, now unto him that is able to keep you, come on,
yes.
Keep you from what? From God is able, bro. God, that's the power of God. The power of God is able to keep you from falling. Then we just read, God is able to make you stand, and God is able to keep you from falling down to those images. If you want that power, you got to want it.
Yes.
You know what? Being saved, you don't nobody make you join the army. You go join it because you desire to fight for the country. You desire to make a difference. No one make you join the army of God. You join the army of God.
But you know what? Joining up, you got to have determination that I'm going to fight wrong. I'm going to fight sin. Amen. Now to him is able to keep you from, thank God, from falling. Amen. While we're right there in John, go back to John, the second chapter. Go back to your left. The book of John, right next to Jude. Go to 1 John. There's 1 John, 2 John, and 3 John. But go to 1 John and go to the second chapter, and let's look at verse number 16 or 15. Love not the world. Huh? Love not the world. Neither the images that are in the world. Love not the world. Neither the things. Brother, there's so many things in this world.
Right.
We're in the world, but we're not of the world. Why? Because greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. God is able to make you stand. God is able to keep you from falling. Love not the world. Come on. What should I be loving? Brother, you should love the Lord thy God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. Brother, your neighbor as yourself. Love God with all you got.
Yes.
When you love God with all you got no love for nothing else. God is first place. Why? Because you set your affection on things above and not on things of this earth or this world. But you got to be set. Your heart got to be set on God. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world is what? The lust of the flesh. The lust of the flesh. That's the problem, satisfying your flesh. That's the problem. Satisfying. I've never heard anybody say the pastor helped me stop smoking. Brother, if you won't stop smoking, it's because you made up in your mind
right. That
I love God more than I love sin.
Amen.
Love, the love of the flesh, the lust of the flesh, the passions of satisfying or feeding the flesh, the lust of the eye.
Yeah.
People got a lust for eye. You got to not love, amen, what you see. Because you may come across things you see, you got to cast it down.
Amen.
You can have a lustful eye. And the pride of life is not of the Father, but of the world. People get so much pride lifted up. They think they get so much knowledge of God's word. Get so much pride because they get lifted up within themselves. Thinking there's somebody. God said, when you think you're something, you're nothing. And it says the world's going to pass away in the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God shall abide forever. The God of this world has blinded many people's eyes. In Daniel the third chapter, as we close, these three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, said, O king, verse 16, to Daniel 3:16, O king, we're not careful. Careful means anxious. Or anxiety, or afraid.
Yeah.
We're not afraid to answer you in this matter.
Yeah.
We're not ashamed to answer you in this matter. We know what we're saying for. We know why we didn't bow to you. It says, if it be so, our God is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thy hand, O king. But if not, If he don't deliver us, if he don't save us, we're going to obey him rather than man.
Amen.
In other words, we're willing to die for what we believe.
Amen.
In order to be saved, you got to be willing to die for it.
Amen.
If you're not willing to die for it, you're not ready to be saved. You can be religious, because when you find a way out, you can slip out for a minute, fall, get back up,
yes,
repent,
amen,
and get back in. That's not willing to die for it.
Amen.
You got to be willing to die for this gospel.
Yes.
You got to be willing to lay down your life. You got to be willing to put your life down. Lay your life down for this gospel.
Yes.
Brother, when saints have been thrown to an arena, football arena, like a football arena,
yeah,
of lions.
Yeah.
And the saints was like on the middle, of the field, and they opened up the cages, and brother lions came out while people were all thousands in the stands screaming. Yeah. And the saints was down there singing and praying as the Romans just devoured the saints with lions. And people got a kick out of it. People paid to come see that. People, saints got put between two horses in opposite directions. And their bodies just ripped apart. And people got a kick out of that. There's people that have died. There's people in certain countries can't even, I can't preach this gospel like this freely in certain countries because you get killed for it. And here we sit with all this luxury in America. Here we sit with all this fine, all this goodness in America. And we're the most laziest people. Don't want to have no stand for God. God help us. People were burned in the stake. I got stories at home where people, when you get a chance, read the book called The Fox Book of Martyrs. When you see the saints put on a pole, man, with weeds all around them and brushes, and they light it up, and people just, and the brother saints singing, "Oh, how great thou art, brother. Oh, how great thou art, dear God. Thank you, God. I want to burn for thee." And as they're going up in the flames, just singing the songs of Zion, brother. And here we are, we can't even say no to sin. We can't even get victory over the little stuff. And people have burned. People have died. People have been thrown to the lions. People have put the fire for this gospel, for what we have. And I can't say no to it. Come on, man. God is able to make you stand. God is able to keep you from falling. I'm just here to tell, I'm just a mailman to give you the information to let you know that you can do all things through Christ that strengthens you. And it says, be it known unto thee, O King, verse 18, we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury, and the form of his face, his visage changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore he spake and commanded that they should heat the furnace once seven times more than it was wont to be heated. And he commanded that the most mightiest men that were in his army, bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and cast them into the burning fiery furnace. And these men were bound in their coats, their horses, their hats, and their other garments, and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's commandment was so urgent, the furnace exceedingly hot, and the flame of the fire slew those, men that took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down bound into the midst of the fiery burning furnace. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king was astounded, and rose up in haste, and said unto the counselors, "Did not we cast three men bound into the midst of the fire?" And they answered and said unto the king, "Yeah, true king, true, O king." He answered and said, "Well, lo, I see four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God, Jesus." Man, look at that. I wonder how he knew how Christ looked and never seen him before. But brother, the world will see Christ in your life. And they got to bow down. Watch what happened. These men are walking around the fire. Can we bow them? They should be cooked by now. They should be burnt chicken. They should be burned up. But they're around it. They died in sin. We gonna have a time. Will we get to heaven? Everybody down there singing songs, man. And they said Jesus was down there walking around with them. And brother, they didn't have no hurt on them. I like that. Brother, sin can't touch you when you have Jesus with you. When you're in the midst of a test, when you're in the midst of a trial, when you're going through sore temptation, he'll make a way for you to escape. That you can bear it, thank God. And the princes and the governors and the captains. Amen. He said, "Did not we cast the fourth man like the Son of God?" Verse 26, "Then Nebuchadnezzar came near the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, ye servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth out of the midst of the fire." And you know what? I'm going to tell y'all something. This all just came on my mind. They changed the king's mind.
That's right.
You know why most people don't get saved? Because of somebody standing in their way. I guarantee you, if you step up to the plate and get saved, whatever or whoever is trying to hinder you from being saved, guess what? They'll get saved too. But guess what? You're going to die and go to hell because you're hindering their soul and you got this knowledge. You are responsible for souls. You are responsible for souls. More souls were saved because they were willing to give up their life and not bow down. And now the whole country, the whole world had to worship the God. Don't you know if you stand, if you take your stand, if you take your stand, God is able to make, God is able to make that relative stand. God is able to make that influence in your life, turn their heart, and they'll get saved.
Right.
But why are you afraid to step away and say, I can't do this no more? Why are you afraid to step away and say, I'm done with sin?
Right.
It will cause them to think about their own soul. I'm sorry, I said this the last. Let me give you one more scripture. Let me show you this here.
God bless you.
We all got me. Let me show you this here. Go to Ezekiel. Watch this. Watch this. I'm going to show you just what I'm talking about. Ezekiel. Hold your place there in Daniel. I'm going to show you something. Ezekiel, the 12th chapter, I believe it is. Ezekiel, the 12th chapter. Y'all stay with me. God has put you and given you the knowledge. God has put you and given you the knowledge that you need to have so you can make a difference. And if you don't change, they won't change.
Right.
You got to be bigger than your problem.
Amen.
Christ is bigger than your problem.
Amen.
Look at Ezekiel 12 and 1. It says, the word of the Lord also came unto me saying, watch this, son of man, thou dwellest, you living in the midst of a rebellious house. Let that sink in for a minute. You're living in rebellion against God, and your house is in rebellion. Your house is disrespectful towards God. And watch this, which have eyes to see and see not. In other words, they have eyes to see, but they can't see God. They have ears to hear, but they hear not what God is saying. Why? For they are a rebellious house. He said, therefore, thou son of man, prepare your stuff for removing. And remove in day by day in their sight. And thou shalt remove from thy place to another place in their sight. It may be. Here's the part I'm getting to. It may be, once you move out, once you move on, once you move up, once you get down to business with God, it may be, watch what's going to happen, it may be that they will consider.
Right. Amen.
But they're not going to consider God until you that have the knowledge get out of the way.
Right. Amen.
You are causing their soul to be lost. All they said, I'm religious. I got my former religion. That's what the Bible said. People got a former religion, but they're not saved from sin.
Amen.
Amen. My Lord. It says that it may be that they also consider what you're doing. You're not giving them nothing to consider by you living in sin with them.
Amen.
Though they be a rebellious house, then shall thou bring forth thy stuff by day in their sight. In other words, don't be ashamed. Don't sneak out. As stuff for removing, and thou shalt go forth at evening in their sight, and as they go forth into captivity.
Right.
Oh my God.
Yes.
And it said, dig through the wall in their sight, and carry out thereby. In other words, dig through and get everything that belongs to you. In their sight, thou shalt bear it upon thy shoulders and carry it forth into the twilight. And thou shalt cover thy face that thou see not the ground. Why? Because God said, I don't want you to go back to it. So I don't want you to know how to get back. So when you leave, cover your face so you don't know how to go back.
My God. Amen.
Brother, when God bring you out, you need to cover your face so you can forget where you come from. Brother, Lord, I don't know where you're taking me to. Lord, I don't know where you're moving me to. I don't know why you're talking to me like this. I don't know why you've been dealing with me like this, God. But Lord, cover my face I can cover your face, brother. I'm going to lead you out of there. So that way, when you open your eyes to your new life, brother, you won't even know how to get back. I thank God I forget how to go back. Bro, we need to forget. The devil try to remind us, but thank God, amen, we don't even think about where God has brought us from. Back to Daniel. Then the king, then Nebuchadnezzar came to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and said, Meshach, Shadrach, Abednego, the servants of the Most High God, come forth hither. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth out of the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Verse 27, and the prince, oh, I like this part. And the princes, governors, and the captains, and the kings, and the counselors being gathered together saw these three men, not the image anymore, upon whose bodies the fire had no power, nor was a hair of their head singed. Neither were their coats changed. God protected them. For the smell of fire had not even passed on them. God said, once you leave sin, sin not gonna have no power on you. It's not like you're not gonna smell like sin no more. Amen. If you get saved, it look different, bro.
All right.
God changed your body. God changed your mind. He changed your outer, bro. He changed everything about you. Glory be to God.
Amen.
Man. Then Nebuchadnezzar spake and said, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who have sent his angel and delivered his servants that trusted in him and have changed the king's word. Oh, my God. And yielded their bodies that they might not serve or worship any god except their own God. They yielded their bodies. You got to yield yourself to God.
Amen.
You got to be willing to hurt yourself. You got to be willing to carry your cross. If it costs you pain, if it costs you suffering, you got to be willing to suffer with the Savior. Therefore, I make a decree that every people, nation, and language would speak anything against amidst the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be made a dunghill, because there is no other God that can deliver from sin after this sort. That can deliver, and I add from sin. Because we know it's symbolic for our time, what we're dealing with, sin. What you're dealing with, sin. Thank God I'm delivered. I mean, I'm talking about our people in our day and age. Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. That last verse, I want you to take note of that. God will promote you.
All right.
God will promote you. God will build you up. God will elevate you. God will set you on the right path, and he will take you a little higher in him. But he'll take your life to the next level. He'll take the life of your family to the next level. Everything you touch, it will turn to gold, so to speak. Everything you touch, it will be blessed. God will bless your going out. He will bless your coming in. God will bless your fruit of your basket. He will bless your storehouse. Amen. He will open up his good treasure unto you, and God will pour out blessings that you have not room to receive. Only if you just step out and receive God, God got blessings for you to promote your life.
Amen.
The Bible says, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard what God has in store for you, what God has prepared for you. But sin is the hindrance from God opening the storehouse of blessings to flow into your life. You got to get rid of the sin. You got to get rid of the Nebuchadnezzar. You got to get rid of the image in your life.
Yes. Amen.
I promise you, because of time's sake, we're going to close. But when you get a chance, read Isaiah the 6th chapter, verse number 1. Isaiah the 6th chapter, verse number 1. I'm going to tell you something about Isaiah. He could not see God because King Uzziah was in his life. But the Bible says when King Uzziah died, when that image died, then he was able to see God. What image in your life got to die first for you to be able to see God? They have eyes to see but see not. They have ears to hear but hear not. The Bible says, he that have an ear, let him hear what the Spirit of God is saying. What is God talking to your heart about? I'm telling you, before you even came to church today, whoever you are, I'm talking to. I'm not pinpointing anybody. I let the Holy Spirit read your life. I don't come to church and throw off on nobody. You all know me by now. I preach what God has given me to preach. I didn't know who was going to be here. This was going to go forth whether you came or not.
Amen, bro.
God have you here for an appointed reason, appointed time, because you're giving in, you're falling, you're not standing, and you're giving, you tired of saying, making new promises. New Year's resolutions, I'm going to stop this, I'm going to quit that. You don't have the power, you can't do it of your own strength. You've been struggling, you need to be sanctified.
Amen.
But in order to be sanctified, you already know there's some things you got to give up. That you walk in that fine line, And you still can say you're saved, but there's still some of your ways that you want to hold on to. You know, sanctification, you got to give up your ways. You can't be saved and not sanctified. You got to get the whole package. You may have to give up some stuff you're wearing.
Right.
You may have to give up some people you're hanging around.
Amen.
Come on now.
Right.
You may have to delete some phone numbers out and some pictures out of your phone. Come
right.
on. There's some people you can't associate with no more. You want to be sanctified.
Amen.
And saved.
Amen.
Come on now, church.
Right.
I know this message didn't bring a whole lot of amens and people flipping over the pews and running down the aisles and doing cartwheels. It wasn't a feel good, but this would have rubbed me the road
that's
right
it,
here, brother.
Right.
That's why these churches are filled today, because preachers want to preach and the Bible said God gonna bless you, your family. God got money if you just put something in the offering today. God, and that's all people want today.
Amen.
They don't want to hear about sin. They don't want to hear about the hell. They want to hear about how God gonna bless them with some new rims
right.
and a new house.
Right. My Lord.
What about my soul? I'm tired. I don't want to be fed no mess, man. I want something real, bro. If anybody that know me, I've been real with you.
Amen.
What image do you need to destroy in order to stand for God? Let us stand.